First of all, thank you, Professor Kannan. What Professor Kannan had just informed you is about two important things. One is about the upcoming SciLab session, which is on 12th October. There is going to be a 2-hour session where he will be demonstrating the power of SciLab along with the large repository that is available with the SciLab application. So the second thing was about a low-cost laptop that is being provided to colleges where there is a requirement of 300 or more. He will be discussing this further in the upcoming interactions. You could also email your queries to our team, who will divert it to Professor Kannan's team, and they will be able to better respond to the queries. So let me start the today's session about on as part of the FDP. We'll be discussing about the OER concerns that have been raised by participants over the past 2 weeks. So, as you all would have seen, in week 2, we have given two definitions of OER that we are going to follow. Just look at the words that have been underlined in this particular slide. Digitized materials offered freely and openly. Whom it is for all educators, students and self-learners to use and reuse for teaching, learning and research. And the key important ideas that has been underlined is freely and openly and use and reuse. Similarly, the second definition also freely available online for everyone to use. This has been underlined. So, what I will do right now is, we will do a small activity. You can use the AVIEW chat to answer this particular question. So, this is a YouTube video. This YouTube video is about what is OER or Open Educational Resources. You can see the person John Bond who had created this video. And my first question is this a digitized material? You can use the AVIEW chat to type in your answer. One is yes, two is no. So, I am getting the initial answers are coming in. So, there are no doubts among the RCs. Yes, this is a digitized material. So, your answer is correct. Yes, it is a digitized material. Now, second question. Is this useful for teachers, learners and researchers? Now, answer this question. Is this video useful for teachers, learners and researchers? So, I see only unanimous answers. Yes, it is useful for teachers, learners and researchers. You can stop polling for a minute right now. I will be asking the next question. You should carefully think about this third question before typing in your answers. Can this be used or reused openly and freely? Now, there is a third option that I have purposely added. Yes, no, cannot say. Okay, now I see a divergence in the answers. There are large number of yeses, but a overwhelming majority of cannot say or third option. And some are saying no. So, based on whatever is that you can see right now from the slides, you cannot say whether it can be used or reused openly and freely. How will you know it? So, the answer currently is cannot say. Now, just look at the next question. Now, I have given you the license of the YouTube video. Now, can you tell me whether it can be used or reused openly and freely? I see mixed response right now, but I think a larger majority is saying it is two. There are some yeses, there are some no's, there is a large number of no, and I don't see any cannot say option coming in. So, the answer as many of you have correctly pointed out, it cannot be used or reused freely and openly. If you want to reuse it, you need to get the permission of the YouTube channel creator, because currently it is in standard YouTube license. What you can do is, you can ask your students or whenever if you want to use it, you can provide the link so that they can. So the standard YouTube license says that anybody can watch it freely and openly in the YouTube player or the YouTube website. So they can go to the YouTube website and watch it freely and openly, but it cannot be used or reused just because it there is a standard YouTube license associated with it. And this is where the significance of open education resources come in. How do you make it open? Can anybody guess how to make this particular video open? This is an open question. You can type in your answers via chat. Okay, so most of the institutes are giving the answers. Yes, you have to do a Creative Commons license specifically allowing for reuse, labeled for reuse. So there is a license within YouTube which provides Creative Commons license labeled for reuse. Then only it could be used freely and openly. Now this is one type of open educational resource or video. Now there is another category of open educational resource that many of you would be familiar with. So hold on to your answers, right? You can stop posting in the answers. Now I am showing you another educational resource. This is a GATE question paper in the electrical stream. So the question number one, is this a digitized material? Yes, it is. So I'm not going to ask you specifically for each questions right now, but I'll ask you when, I'll be giving you the specific instruction when to vote. It is digitized material. Yes, it is useful for teachers, learners and researchers. But this is the question that I want to ask you. Can this be used or reused openly and freely? So I have given the website address from where I have downloaded this, I have taken the image. So this is from the GATE website. There is a folder called 2015 questions and it has been provided by the GATE organizing committee. So when I gave the description, I suddenly see that from no and can't say, answers are moving towards yes and can't say. So technically you cannot reuse or use it openly and freely because it has not been given any specific license. It is very ambiguous, and so whether there is a copyright associated to it or so it will all depend on what is IITG's, so what is written in the IITG's website, whether there is a copyright on website and its resources. So the same holds good for the answer key that is associated with the same question paper. So unless and until specified whether it is under Creative Commons, it is very ambiguous whether it could be used or reused. And this is where the significance of open educational resources come in. So when all of you, whether you have a video, whether you have a question paper, whether you have a solved answer sheet or any other resource that you associate with regular teaching learning process like explanations, course web pages, materials that you provide, notes and everything, to make it freely and openly for use and reuse, you need to provide Creative Commons license, and that is what we intend throughout the both the FDPs. We are creating lot of these open educational resources. So all the assignments that you do, all the questions that you ask, everything is part of the Creative Commons right now. So all the video interactions that we are having even right now is streamed through YouTube, and we are going to apply the Creative Commons license on it. And when you register for the workshop in the NMAICT website, you actually give a declaration. So you have to accept a declaration saying that all the resources that I provide in this particular as part of this workshop is in Creative Commons. I agreed to provide it in Creative Commons. So the entire IIT Bombay X courses and other resources associated with it is in open source. So anybody can use it, and it is free and open. So now moving on to the OER activity that you are going to do in the coming week. So we have been giving you instructions from week 2 onwards, but let me, so I have seen a lot of queries and concerns raised by different participants, and even the mentors were sharing the same concerns. So let me just tell you why this OER activity is there. So many of you would be handling courses which have course project, maybe in the second year, third year, or towards the final year. This is a very common activity in higher education. So our OER activity can be thought of as a course project for this FDP. And since this is a course project, we are explicitly mandating it to be a group activity. So it should not be done by individual, it should be done by a group activity. Why? Because one objective of this FDP is to develop a collaborative community. And unless and until you form groups and do work, collaborative communities will not emerge. An important thing about the OER activity is that it focuses both on the process and the product. So the product over here is the actual OER that you create. So the OER could be a video that you create, an LED, a quiz, or a LBD that you create for the video, or separate online quizzes that you create for your students, the answer keys or explanations on how to work out this quiz, or even a course web page that you create for your own students. So all these could be OERs. But it is not just sufficient to provide this resource. For somebody else to use and reuse it, you should also provide the process that you have followed for creating such a open educational resource. Then only the actual benefit of the resource is maximized. You can think of it as an integration activity along with detailed documentation. So the OER formation, these are the steps that you have been doing till now. So initially we have given an instruction that there should be a team with not more than 3 members. Only in explicitly rare cases where teams have not been formed do we allow for 4 members team. Every team should have a team leader. Why? Because at the end of this workshop, it will, the activity for OER submission will be open only for the team leaders. Team members should regularly communicate during the OER creation, and every communication has to be logged or documented. In fact, the entire OER process has to be documented. That is a clear mandate that we have for this particular activity. So then after forming a team, the team discusses, decides on a topic for creating OER. This is then communicated to the mentors or the associate faculties, because some of the team members may be part of different mentors. So the mentors should know what the participants are actually, or the mentees are actually doing as part of the course project. And this should also be communicated to IIT Bombay workshop team, because since only the team leader gets gets grades for the activity in the IIT Bombay X platform, the IIT Bombay team will distribute the mark that has been received for the IIT, the team leader, to the other team members. So if you don't give the correct team leader and team details, your own marks are going to be affected. And we had created a survey last week. Actually, 2 surveys were created. The first survey was through the NMACT dashboard, because that is the place where the certificate, all your registration information have all been collected and organized. So we had asked a survey question asking you around 10 to 12 questions. But unfortunately, there some things didn't work out. What didn't work out? First of all, not all participants have submitted this survey. There were duplicate entries. So the same person has actually given in twice. Even more larger issue, there were ambiguity in entries. So one team member has written, I have 2 colleagues with me, so-and-so email ID, so-and-so, this is team number, member 1, team member 2. But his colleague has written only one other team member's name. So at IIT Bombay end, we are confused as to which entry should we take. Another larger issue, not all the responses were in standard form. So we had asked you to separate the email IDs by comma, because at our end, since there are around 5000 participants, we use automated scripts to filter these out and populate the team. But since not all of them were in standard form, so for example, somebody have used comma, somebody have used instead of just email ID, somebody has written name, comma, email ID, comma, some other details. So some all these kind of problems have come in the first survey. To sort this out, we have created a second survey. We had asked you to fill this survey by yesterday evening, but what we see again is that some of these errors are being repeated. So what I would request all of you right now is, if you have already filled the survey, do not fill it again. But all those participants who have not filled the survey, kindly fill it by today evening. We will be opening it till 5:30 p.m. today. So you can use this link bit.ly/OER_2017 to go and submit the survey. Please note that you have to carefully fill the survey. You have to give us the correct team details, the correct team leader, and the correct topic. We use an automated script where we collect only the first entry. So for example, if somebody has written two or three, you have filled the survey form twice or thrice, the program at the back end will only look at the first correct entry. The first entry, the remaining entries will be discarded. If your team members, so for those people who have filled in the team details till now, please check that you have filled in the correct details. So what we'll do is, at the end of today, we'll consolidate all these team details and we'll publish it in IIT Bombay X. If there are issues, you can check your team details in IIT Bombay X, and then there will be a correction survey that is going to be created. So we'll reopen this survey, or what do you say, we'll do a new third survey tomorrow, only if there are corrections required. If there are corrections required, we'll open a third survey where we'll ask the exactly the same thing, but that will be the final survey. We will collect all the information of the teams and then we'll republish this list on Monday. Now, I have just checked the list yesterday evening, which was supposed to be the last date. We have around 1004 unique teams as of now, with around 2300 participants. Now I know that total there are around 5100 participants in this particular FDP. So what we are talking out is, there are 3000 participants who have not formed a team or have not filled the survey. Please note that the course project activity or the OER activity is a mandatory activity, and you will not get certified unless and until you submit this OER activity in FDP201x. We will be detailing the grading policies and other information regarding OER in a short while, by today evening. In today evening sessions, I will take one more session about the OER grading policy. But what we have provided you is a OER guideline document. So the documentation that should be submitted at the end, along with an example OER. This example OER, it is an exemplar that you can take for creating your own OER documentation in this FDP. If that isn't sufficient, you can also look at all the mentors. So we had shared the mentors web pages in FDP101. So we will be doing that again. Each of your mentors were part of this OER process and they have also done OER documentation in the previous FDP, and they have uploaded it in their WordPress web pages. What you can do is, you can go and visit these web pages and look at these examples that they have also created. But mind you, do not plagiarize. So if you want to use that particular resource or part of the resource, you are free to use it, but provide sufficient citation to the source. So So the source is that particular website created by the team that your mentor was part of. So all these things need to be detailed while you are creating your OER. What I'll do right now is, I hope most of you clear with the OER guidelines. We have just overshooted the first session by 10 minutes. What we'll do is, we'll restart the session at 11:45. But at this point, I'll just take two quick questions. One is from, so two hand raises have come. Please listen to the, if your question is regarding OER, I'll just answer it right now. So the question should be about OER. Otherwise, I will not be answering it in the current session. I'll redirect it to the next session. So first, it's RC1013, MEPCO Schenck Engineering College.
The thing is, we have created all the OER documentation and we have did all the things.
Mm-hmm.
And when is the deadline to submit to IIT Bombay?
Okay, I'll so the question is about deadline. I'll inform about the due dates in a short while. See, as I told you, there are around 3000 participants who have not yet given us the details of OER. So unless and until we get the full team details, it will be very hard, it will be harsh on all the participants if I set up due dates. But all the OER activity, we are trying to end it by so the activities will be released somewhere around next week. If we have the full team by full team details by Sunday, it will take our team another 2 days to process the entire information and create the backend for accepting the OERs. So you can expect, so Wednesday night at around 10 o'clock is the positive expectation that we are keeping for starting the OER submission activity. The review activities will start from 18th of this month. So we are giving 8 days for submission of OER activity.
Another question, can we cite resources from spokentutorial.org apart from YouTube and Screenomatic videos?
Sure, sure. So most of the OER. Spoken tutorial, so the question is, can the resources be cited from spoken tutorial? Yes, Spoken Tutorial is a free and open source project, but you have to, so you'll have to form a use appropriate citation conventions, like this has been accessed from so and so website, spokentutorial.org. If there is a specific website, you should put that, and also the date on which you have accessed it last. So if you actually look at the slides that I have uploaded, so I have also uploaded today's session slide in IIT Bombay X, have given the information of how to cite a website that you are accessing. So you can use that particular citation convention and cite the spoken tutorial resources. I'll now move to the next, the final question, 1003, LDRP Institute of Technology and Research, Gandhinagar, Gujarat.
Sir, I am a single person of chemical engineering from RC1093.
Okay.
And I cannot fill the survey form.
No, everybody.
What should I do?
No, no. So everybody can fill the survey form. And if you are a single participant, there is an option. You have not formed a team yet. When you answer it as no, then you are taken to a section where instructions for single team members are provided.
In that, I don't have to give any kind of my topic name or anything like.
So, if you are a single team member, how will you decide on the topic unless and until you have a team? The OER activity is a group activity.
I am preparing the OER for heat exchangers.
Yeah, that is fine. But
single alone.
Currently, you don't have a team member, right? So, first and foremost, the major criteria for OER activity is that you have to be part of a team before you start deciding on the OER topic, because the primary aim of this activity is collaboration and then build upon the resource. So it is perfectly valid that you are creating your own open educational resource, but as part of the course project, it is required that you collaborate with somebody else and together you create a resource.
Any person from not participant in this program,
no.
Can I
so
make OER with them?
No, you cannot, because the participant has to be from the same program. So what IIT Bombay will do is, we will look at the people who have not yet formed team, and if there is another person from chemical or chemistry which is similar to your domain, we'll club you with that person, and together you can then decide and discuss on the OER topics.
Hello, JK. Yeah. There is another question from our center.
Okay.
Sir, I want a little bit clarification about flipped classroom. Like, is it a group or single activity, and does the topic can differ from OER topic or not?
Yeah, so flipped classroom assignment or RCA 02 is an individual activity, and it can be different from your OER. It is an individual assignment.
And the topic can also be different from
yes. OER topic. So I hope questions are clear. The two questions that I have clarified, please note that we will be coming back in another 20 minutes. Around 11:40 we will rejoin for the second session. So you can reserve your queries for OER, because we will be answering it in the afternoon session. So at this moment, I would request the people who have not yet filled the survey to fill the survey by today evening. So today evening 5:30 is the last the due date and due time for the survey. We'll be closing the survey at 5:30 sharp. So we will break now for another 20 minutes. You can have your tea. We'll rejoin at 11:40. Welcome back to the session. So I understand that there are a lot of queries regarding the OER survey. So let me just repeat the main instruction once again. Many of you have already submitted your entry in for that survey. Around 2000 people have already submitted. So from what we'll do is, we'll our program at backend will take the first entry that you have submitted, and we'll publish this entire consolidated list by tomorrow. So the survey has been kept open till today evening. So all those who have not yet submitted, we will ask you to submit by today evening 5:30 p.m. This is a strict deadline. If you do not follow this deadline, you will not be able to participate in the RCA 3 assignment, that is the OER creation activity. Please note that OER creation activity is mandatory for getting a certificate in FDP 201. We have given clear instructions in the survey as to what we will, the process that is going to be applied for people who have not yet joined a team or formed a team. So all these will be collected, and we will be putting you into appropriate teams after we consolidate the team list. If suppose there are some corrections required in your team, we will be, along with the team list tomorrow, we will be creating a correction survey. You can put the specific correction that you want in the correction survey, and that will be treated as a final entry. Regarding the submission of OER activities, people who have already started with OER activities, please do not worry, continue with your activity. Once the team list have been finalized, it will take us 2 days minimum to create the process flow within IIT Bombay X for accepting the OER submissions. Only the team leaders will be allowed to submit their OERs. So what you have to do is, once this submission is done, every team has to review a minimum of 3 other teams, and all these will be consolidated at our end. So the submissions will start within 2 days. So if everything goes well and all the corrections are rectified by tomorrow evening, you will have the OER submission activity created by Tuesday evening. If it has not been corrected till tomorrow evening, the OER submission activity will be released on Wednesday evening. So the submissions can start from by Wednesday at the maximum, and you will get another 8 days more to submit, and there will be another 5 more days to review. So the review will start parallelly. The submissions will go on, and the reviews also will start parallelly around 18th. So I believe 18th is the next Wednesday. Yes. So hopefully the submissions we can hopefully start by 10th or at least by 11th evening we'll start the submissions, and the reviews will start from 18th, and we are going to give you 7 more days for review. So the entire activity we are going to wind up by 25th. So instead of the earlier announced date of 22nd, we'll have to extend it by 3 more days for the reviews to happen and everyone to get a consolidated list. So if there are further queries about the OER survey or OER team formation, there will be an interaction session towards the final session, that is from 4 o'clock. You can raise your queries at that point of time. Now we will move on to the next session, that is integrating MOOCs in regular education. Typically a traditional MOOC will have the following elements: videos, practice activities, reference materials, other web resources and discussion forum, and all these are related to the particular course. And what all are the different MOOCs, who all can access these MOOC resources? So by definition, if it is a pure MOOC or massively open online MOOC, then anyone can access, which means that you, your students or anyone whom you know can access these MOOC resources by registering to these courses. Where will you get these courses? So these are some of the typical MOOC providers: edX, Coursera, FutureLearn, P2P University, Udacity, Code Academy, MIT OpenCourseWare. There are lots of these MOOC providers who are available. If you want to get a detailed list, you can go to classcentral.com, which is a MOOC aggregator. It is a aggregator of all the MOOCs. So you will get all the details of different MOOCs that are available, that are released for public from this particular website. Now consider this scenario. You went to either the Class Central website or in any of the other MOOCs that I said, let's say edX. You found a good MOOC that will be useful supplement to a course that you are taking in the current semester. So suppose you are a computer science teacher, and in edX you found an introduction to computer science course in edX. So consider this scenario. What you do right now is you join the course and also ask all the students who are your all your students in the first year to register for this course. Once you have registered and the course is open, you see that the first week of this MOOC has 3 videos and 10 quiz questions that is exactly from the same topic that you are currently teaching. And assume that all these resources are in Creative Commons. Now take a minute in your RC, think individually of one way in which you will use these MOOC resources. So let me go back to the scenario. You have found a good MOOC, you have registered in the MOOC, and so have your students. Once you have registered in the course, you see that there are 3 videos in the first week and 10 quiz questions that is exactly aligned to the topic that you are teaching currently. Now think of one way in which you will use these MOOC videos and questions in your own classroom. At this moment, we would encourage everyone to think about this question. We'll give you the time to download the slides. It will be uploaded in IIT Bombay X website under course handout. You can think individually for a minute. Now I'll move to the pair phase. So you have thought of one way in which you will integrate within your classroom. So discuss your idea with your peer, who is just sitting next to you, your neighbor. Discuss your ideas together and then come up with one way in which you can integrate these MOOC resources. So there were videos, there were questions in your internal test. So it could be a mid-semester exam or it could be a class assignment. So there are multiple things that you as a teacher can do in your classroom. So together, both of you have to come up in with one way in which you will use these MOOC resources or MOOC content in your own internal assessment within your classroom. So, at this point, we would ask, we would request all of you to pair up and discuss. You have 5 minutes to discuss this. So, what I have done right now, you would have seen the videos of how different RCs are performing. So, RC1073, I saw a very good practice where people, there were only two of them, but they were discussing the answer. RC1013, I see that participants are sitting alone. RC1001, again participants are sitting alone, but I would encourage you to discuss. Now, let me come to the share face instruction. So, I hope all of you have interacted with your peers, and we had asked you to come up with one way in which you can integrate these MOOC resources in your internal test. So, in the share face, what I will do now is, I will remove all the hand raises now. I would request the RCs who have discussed the idea to share your, use the hand raise button to share. What I will do is, I will come to the first three RCs, then we will do a poll to see how many of you have similar ideas. So, the remote center coordinator, you can provide me with what one pair has discussed, and you can share it with me. So, internally share it within your remote center, and then remote center coordinator, you can give the mic to one of the group and they will share this idea to everyone else. So, let me go to the first hand raise. So, the first hand raise is from Tezpur University.
We have discussed about this matter and come to the end, like the videos in the MOOC course can be used as flipped classroom activity.
Okay.
And the, regarding about the assessment, internal assessment, you can ask the students also to appear in the exam. And whatever the marks they get on the exam, that can be considered as one of the internal assessment in the current course.
Okay. So, I'll just repeat what the participant from Tezpur University is saying. The videos from the MOOC resources can be used for flipped classroom strategies as a out of class activity, and then some in class segment activity can be done on the basis of the video. And what was the assessment that you said, the assessment practice? RC1153, how are you planning to integrate in the internal assessment?
There are several exams in internal assessment.
Okay.
One of those exams, you can consider the exam conducted that conducted in the MOOC course.
So,
whatever the mark you can only get, you can collect that mark for our internal assessment.
Okay. So, what you are, this is what the, so correct me if I am wrong. So, what you are planning to do is, you will ask all the students to answer the MOOC quiz, the graded quiz that is coming in the MOOC, and you will individually collect these marks and factor it in your internal assessment. Am I right?
Okay. Right.
Great idea. So, let me just ask the other RCs. So, the idea is that that has been provided is, use videos for flipped classroom and use the MOOC graded question marks for internal assessment. So, there is not going to be a separate internal assessment. They will directly use the MOOC's graded exam scores in internal assessment. How many of you share a similar idea? So, within your RC, you can just check. You can give me a percentage number as to how many of you had a similar idea. So, the remote center coordinator, you can just check within your RC and tell me how many of your participants shared a similar idea. 1%, 5%, 10%. So, yeah. So, some answers are coming. SVERI RC1281 is saying that 50% had similar idea. Mahalingam College also says 50%. RC1036, 100% people had alternate idea. BMS College also says 100%. 1073, 100%. National Institute of Technology, Silchar, 75%. Thyagarajar College, 25%. BH Gardi College 50%. So it seems, sir, that your idea has been accepted by a large majority of participants across the country. So congratulations, and congratulations to all other participants who thought of this idea at your own remote center as well. However, let me ask you a quick question. Let me play the devil's advocate. What if all these graded questions are released at the start and the students sit together, identify the correct answers, and then go on and do those questions? How will you tackle this?
You can do like this. You can arrange one lab and you can ask all the students to appear the graded test in front of my invigilation or the instructor's invigilation. So the copying can be avoided.
Okay. So, the idea that has been said is the students will be asked to take the test in front of the teacher, and this idea is called proctored examination. So, this idea, its technical term is called proctored examination, and many, so the Coursera or EDX provide certificates through such a mechanism wherein there will be a proctor who will log in via some conferencing software, and you will have to log into your computer screen, and you are not allowed to do use any other applications at that particular point of time, and the proctor is just observing what you are doing, so there will be a webcam and he will be able to see what all you are doing, and he will have access to your computer screen, and they do this particular exam. So this is how some MOOCs provide these verified certificates. So, what you are, the practice that you are currently seeing is a very valid practice, and this is very useful. This is one way of integrating the MOOCs within your own regular teaching learning process. So, for people who are saying that reshuffling of questions, so thank you, sir, for sharing this idea. So, I hope the people all over have understood one way of using MOOCs in their regular teaching learning. So, they can use the content for flipped classroom, for designing their own flipped classroom activity, and then they can ask the students to give the graded examination in front of the teacher. So, it becomes a small proctored exam, just like other internal internal exams that you are having within your own institution. So, let me now go to the second RC, RC1173, Tyagarajar College. What I would want is a different idea from what has already been said. Okay, so I understand around 25% of people from your RC had similar answer, but what I would require is a different answer. Yes, ma'am, go on.
I am Parkavi from Tyagaraja College of Engineering.
Yeah.
Currently, I am handling the subject social network analysis.
Okay.
For the subject, I have used NPTEL and both Coursera as an online activity.
Great.
And I instruct my students to enroll to these two courses.
Okay.
And as a flipped classroom activity, I have given the videos from an NPTEL. And followed by the flipped classroom activity, I have quizzes to my students, and the quizzes is based on the videos only, and I have set the time limit also. For example, if the video limit is 30 minutes, I give only 1 hour to watch the video and attend the quiz followed by the video. So there is no replicate, and the students are not allowed to discuss their answers. And I also give the shuffled questions. The provisions are also available in the canvas.instructor.com. The
okay.
Canvas is an online learning management systems. And I also used quizzes for out-class activity. And for in-class activity, I have used ThinkPadShare to describe the concepts. And finally, I instruct my students to complete any one certificate, either from NPTEL or Coursera. And I give incentives. The incentives are added to the CAT exams, that is internal examinations.
Okay. So, brilliant. I hope others have listen to this detailed explanation that was provided. Let me repeat what the colleague from Tyagarajar College was telling in this particular interaction. So what she is doing right now is she is taking a course on social network analysis, and there are MOOCs, open MOOCs available in NPTEL and Coursera related to this particular course. Like my other the other colleague from Tezpur University, who did who is planning to do a flipped classroom activity, the integration into regular teaching learning practice is almost the same, flipped classroom. But there is a small difference that the colleague from Tyagarajar College is giving the quizzes also as out of class activity, and uses think pair share to facilitate conceptual understanding of the topics discussed in the videos and quizzes. What she also mentioned is, while administering the videos and while doing this particular activity, she gives exactly 1 hour for the students. And how does she do it? She uses a open learning management software known as Canvas. It is something like a Moodle. So consider different. So it's a different software, but the function is the same. It's a learning management system. The name of the system is Canvas. So she uses that particular learning management system to administer this all these activities. But additionally, the last line that she said is the most important thing. If the students complete the course and get a certificate, that is being factored into the internal assessment. So there is some grade or some percentage of mark. Ma'am, can you tell me what is the approximate percentage that you typically give for these? Suppose a student gets a certificate, how much mark does he or she get in the internal assessment?
5 marks.
5 marks.
Actually, total assessment mark is 50.
Okay, so out of 50, you give 5 marks. So out of 50, 10% of the internal assessment is given for the credit that the student gets in the MOOC, either NPTEL or Coursera. So it is, since there are two MOOCs, the students can do any one of them and get the credit. And let me tell you a formal name of doing this. Okay, so there is a formal system of doing this. This is part of the, I mean, a portion of this is what we call the credit transfer, but you are doing it in a very minute manner. Typically for credit transfer actually means whatever they have done, all that gets factored in as the complete course credit. So if you have a same social network analysis course, which has almost similar syllabus, doing the MOOC is good enough for the participant, and getting a certificate is good enough. It's a good alternative to doing the course inside the classroom. But since you have the constraints that you have to do the assessment, you have to factor in the marks, so you are doing a partial credit transfer in your own practice. So I hope many of the institutions who are participating in this remote, in this FDP, would be noting that there are some credits for these kind of innovative practices when NBA comes for accreditation. And there is also a push for credit transfer through MOOCs that is being taken up by the Ministry of Human Resources. So these are some good examples. So let me just check with other RCs. How many of you do at least one partial credit transfer in your own practice? So within the remote center, please ask the colleagues how many of them will consider a certificate in one of these MOOCs for a small percentage. So it's like roughly 10% of internal assessment. How many of the RC, how many of the participants are actually doing it in their own teaching learning practice? So you can just have a quick count and tell me an approximate percentage. So 1042 St. Gith's College, we are considering it partially good. Any other RCs who are doing this particular practice? 1281, 10% within RC1281 is doing this. RC1173, so I believe that Tyagarajar College, 75% of the people are doing this. Excellent. 1235, Dr. Mahalingam College, 20% of people are doing this. MES, Pillai's Institute, Panvel, 20%. SKN Singhat College, 20%, 20-25%, 20%, 50% from SB Patil College. SMS Lucknow, 10% people. So somebody is doing 100% considered for partial credit. So there are, so once again, I congratulate both Ms. Parkavi and all the other instructors who are taking such an initiative for integrating these kind of innovative practices within your own teaching learning practice. So what you can see now is how different people from different colleges are actually doing the same thing, and you are actually sharing these good practices and ideas, and there are, these are all formal practices. So like what I said earlier, proctored exam, this is how typical MOOC aggregators do it. What you are talking of partial credit, in fact IIT Bombay, so there is a IIT Bombay X consortium formed of around 50 to 60 autonomous institutions. So they had taken CS101X, which is equal to introductory computer science, then there is a course on thermodynamics and a course on signals and systems. So one mechanical, one electrical and one computer science course were offered in a blended format. So over there, they could supplement their regular lectures with these IIT Bombay X lectures offered by Professor Fatak, Professor Gaitonde and Professor V.M. Gadre and their team. And these were factored into their regular assessment. So we have around 60 institutions who are familiar with this process, and to facilitate teachers to take the mark, we had a MIS system through which they can track the progress of the students. So this was the initial idea behind the blended MOOCs, wherein MOOCs can be integrated seamlessly into the regular teaching learning practice. I'll just check whether Professor Fatak is available at the RC, because this is a right time for him to start off. So Professor Fatak is, will be, again, Professor Fatak is now visiting individual RCs and he will be joining us from one of the RCs. I'll just check whether he is available.
He will be arriving soon. Okay. I'll please check with the...
Yeah, so what you can do is just inform the studio team. We'll be coming directly live to you once Professor Fatak is in, because he'll be speaking about these blended MOOCs, because it was his vision that initially triggered out the idea of blended MOOCs. So it will be a good idea for all the participants who are in this FDP to hear from Professor Fatak about this vision of integrating MOOCs into their regular teaching learning. So I believe Professor Fatak is in at this moment. Good morning, Professor Fatak. So Professor Fatak, let me just summarize what has happened just now. So this session is about integrating MOOCs in regular teaching learning practice, and currently we have interacted with two remote centers. So the idea was, we gave a scenario wherein faculty were asked to think and discuss about how they can integrate MOOC content in their regular teaching learning practice. So RC1153, Tezpur University, they first talked of using flip classroom strategy to integrate the video content and use the assessment within the MOOC as part of the internal assessment itself. And then there was RC1175, 1173, Tyagarajar College, where a particular participant, so around 75% of participants in RC Tyagarajar College, they are doing partial credit from the MOOCs, wherein they accept the NPTEL course completion and or Coursera or the other MOOC course completion for roughly 10% of their internal assessment, within their internal assessment. So in the first part, and what I saw from the interaction with other participants is that the flipped classroom strategies is being overwhelmingly used by many of the participants. So we have centers where 100%, several centers where this was used by 100% of the current participants, and the partial credit is being used by again several of them, but at a lower level. So 20% to 50%. But there are some institutions who are using a complete partial credit. So with this, I'll just hand over the session to you, wherein you can speak a little more about the ideas of blended MOOCs and proctored exams.
So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to speak from one of the remote centers. I must first of all acknowledge with thanks the facilitation that is being provided by federal institution, and I am particularly delighted to be here today. Coming back to the topic at hand, much is made out of the flipped classroom, but I would like to actually start with a note of caution. You see, when we do a conventional lecture in the classroom and you do your work at home, I think that is one extreme state of the pendulum of teaching learning process. If we completely flip the classroom, where we say that absolutely no explanatory lecture will ever be given in the class, the entire class will be only activities, activities and activities and discussions, and you must listen to the lectures at home only. That is, I have now come to believe, is another extreme state of the pendulum, and no extreme state is desirable because none of them are stable states. If you look at the flipped classroom expectation that students will actually view your lectures at home, you will find that the entire global statistics is against such assumption. People don't watch videos at home. Many of them will watch it as 2x speed or 3x speed. We, in terms of content creation, we believe that if we make our video lecture snippets or things very interesting, then people will listen to them. It is only partly true. If we reduce the duration of the video lectures, then they will perhaps view it more regularly. This also is partly true. That is the reason why our team has introduced the notion of a learning dialogue rather than a lecture. And this dialogue means that it cannot be just a monologue. So even if it is a 6 minute or 8 minute video clip, I should not be speaking alone. Instead, after any 2 or 3 minutes, I should actually figure out an activity that the listener can do, whether alone or in small groups. It may be almost a trivial activity, but pertaining to the theme, the point is to get the engagement of that listener, get the engagement of that learner, because that learner is alone, not in a classroom environment. Similarly, in a classroom, when I conduct a flipped classroom, there is absolutely no problem if during the discussion session it transpires that majority of the participants have not clearly understood a specific concept or so. There is absolutely no issue if I, as a teacher, decide to take an additional example and spend 10 minutes in giving actually a lecture, provided I do the following. I record whatever I have done, preferably in the classroom itself or separately, and add that as an additional video component of an additional learning dialogue that I have contributed to. This could also be done by the participants. In general, of course, it is well known that the flipped classroom kind of approach in teaching learning significantly enhances the learning. But let me take this thread of my earlier suggestion that I might actually give a small additional lecture even in a blended MOOC scenario. Taking that thread further, I would say that even if I am using
re-recorded lectures of some experts as a part of my blended MOOC program for the flipped classroom, I should independently create at least some learning dialogues on my own, which could perhaps reflect the local understanding, the local situation, the local industry problem, or whatever you have. If nothing else, I could add a flavor of using a local language while giving some explanation, particularly to the first year or second year classes where people have language problem. The point I'm making is that such facilitation will require that the original learning dialogues or video lectures which are created, the original quizzes which are created, all of them must be available as an open educational resource. Because otherwise, I as a teacher in one of the colleges will not feel empowered and encouraged to add value by changing that, by modifying it, or by adding my own thing to it, which is what will make the entire OER collection more and more valuable as time passes. I will mention this once again, that creation of OER, contribution of OER to some kind of a repository which we are going to create in IIT Bombay anyway, plus constant modification and addition to that OER set, I think is now becoming a prime responsibility for all of us. Because once that repository is created, each one of us can draw from it and use it in various courses or whatever we are doing. Towards this end, I think it is extremely important that faculty members in different institutions form small groups and start working collaboratively. We have learnt it the hard way in IIT Bombay, although each individual teacher plans one's own flipped classroom concept and so on. But we have found that whenever we work as a group of two or three or four faculty members, the quality of the final thing that comes out is far greater, because we then have an advantage of inputs and criticism from all colleagues. Secondly, there is also another advantage of working in a group. If I am alone, even if I have planned to spend, let's say, 4 hours a week for the next 4 or 5 weeks to contribute to an OER, after second week my enthusiasm may die, I might find something else more important and pressing. But if there is a group of 4 or 5, then just like why we have a classes, there is a class timing, classroom discussion, etc., etc., which means whether I like it or not, I go to the class. Similarly, if I have a community of 4 or 5 people and we work on a timetable, let's say we decide we should meet to discuss this particular OER once a week for just 20 minutes. Now, once the meeting is scheduled, even if I have something else pressing, I will not miss it because I am a member of that consortium or that group. In short then, these techniques and the emerging pedagogy is only as useful as we A, practice it, and B, contribute to the creation of corresponding. And such practice and such contributions are best done in community. Collaborating communities is a very fundamental theme. I think we are going to stress on this. Some wikis, etc., are going to be delivered. Incidentally, through some other project, a sister project sponsored by Ministry of Culture, where we are building the National Virtual Library of India, we are also building a site for collaborating communities. We will be unraveling the first version of that by the end of this year. And from January, different people will be encouraged to use this site to build and operate small or large collaborating communities. We propose that that will be made available along with wikis and all that we create here. But it is extremely important that apart from working alone individually, if we can also work collectively, 3 or 4 people in small groups, domain specific maybe. And ideally, if the whole institution can say that all the faculty members of my institute form a larger group, and although it is not part and parcel of my normal teaching activities, but let us say once in a month, a brief meeting is held for say even 10 minutes where a review is taken of which are groups which are doing what, and if there is any problem that can be sorted out at the institutional level, I think it will go a long way in creating an environment where not just few faculty members who are interested, but everybody gets encouraged to participate and to contribute. That's all I had to say. Thank you so much. Over to you, Jayakrishnan. And once again, I am very happy to be in your alma mater.
Thank you, Professor Phatak. A big hi to all the all my teachers at Federal Institute. Thank you. So I was just mentioning to Professor Phatak day before yesterday that you are actually going to visit my alma mater. So do convey my special greetings to all my teachers who are there. Like what Professor Phatak said, it is important that while you are integrating MOOC resources within your own group, within your own teaching learning, you have to add value to what you are doing, what the MOOC has already provided. So for example, in the earlier case, they were doing specific activities like think, pair, share. So it's not just doing in-class assignments, but focusing on improving the conceptual understanding. Also, let's say people are having doubts or they did not get some ideas clarified from the videos in MOOC or the activities in MOOC, then these kind of TPS along with lectures, so it need not be a 100% active learning session. Rather, active learning is interspersed within your own regular lecture. These kind of activities will add value to the content that has already been presented to the students, and they will understand the significance of doing a lot of these activities. And once again, like what I saw in the chat, so there is actually a group of people who are doing it. So for example, in some RCs there were 75% of people who are doing it. Such collaboration is required. So while they are doing it, it is also important that each of them talk with each other as to how they tried a particular activity, how, what all actually worked out in that, why, how did they design this entire TPS activity or the flipped classroom segment of it. And that is exactly what the OER documentation is all about. So you would create a good online course from the MOOC resources or other resources that are available, or your own resources as well. But the OER documentation actually explains to somebody else as to how to actually integrate these particular resources effectively in your classrooms. There is a section where we actually ask you to think of mechanisms to evaluate it. So you found an excellent video and you put that as a flipped classroom out of class activity, and you see that 90% of the students, even after viewing that video, did not understand it. So how is this evaluation done? You may do some small questions out of the class, and based on that you will come to know how many of these people actually understood it, and based on that you will design your in-class activity or make modifications in this in-class activity. So all these things have to be discussed with each other, because only when you interact with somebody else you will come to know of all the practical difficulties that one may face while doing all these processes. And now once the discussion is over, you can do a better or refined planning of how to integrate this well in your classroom. So I'll take one more center. Let me go to a center where we have not interacted yet. So RC1094, Lourdes Mata College of Engineering. I'm unable to see the video, but you can try to speak. So the idea is, what kind of mechanisms through which you integrate MOOC resources within your classroom? So RC1094.
We can integrate MOOC in your regular classroom activities by giving the videos through WordPress site or Moodle.
Okay.
Then asking the students to do quizzes in Moodle. Okay. We can give a set of jumbled questions in Moodle.
Okay.
And thus we can grade them.
Okay. So this is again here the resources, the idea that has been shared with us is that these videos and other things, so I have already said that the videos are in Creative Commons. So what the participant is saying is they can actually use this video in their own online courses, and they can do jumbled questions or create new questions based on the video in that Moodle and give to the students. Let me just check how many other RCEs have a similar answer to what has been already said. So it's not purely what you face to face, but using that as using the MOOC resources itself as an online course, a part of online course itself. How many other people share a similar idea? So RCEs can tell how many percentage. So it is a form of flipped classroom itself, but the online part contains a lot more activities, the videos and other activities. So yes, RC1103, they are saying 30% of people had similar ideas, 50%, 40%, 60%, 40%, 60%, so 35%. So ma'am, I believe that lot more people are sharing your idea, but I'll just add on, it's not just sufficient that online activities are provided. You should take up corresponding sessions within your class where you explain the content a little more, give more explanations to the student as to how these answers came up or how what was being discussed in this video, for ensuring that the learning becomes more effective. So let me now move on to another RC, St. Xavier's College 1026.
What I think is that the question part in MOOCs can be used for revisions, because integrating them with internal assessment may be problematic because the university gives basic structure for internal assessment tests. But on the other hand, when it comes to revisions and such things, we can make use of that, because revisions that they come apart or they are far from the structure, internal assessment structure, and that will be useful for the students too.
Okay, so how do you so typically when are these revisions done? Before the exams or towards the end of the course? What are you suggesting?
Usually towards the end of the course, just before the study holidays.
Just before the study holidays. Okay, so this is one more unique way of using MOOCs. Thank you, sir, for the idea. So the idea is that the MOOC resources can be provided for revisions. So you have so there is a constraint at this particular RC that there is a very specific structure through which internal assessment has to go through. So it is very difficult to incorporate many of these practices in their regular curriculum. But what they have thought of differently is using these MOOC resources, the questions and videos and the other additional resources like websites or other things for revisions. So providing revision to the students before they go for study holidays. So this is excellent alternate use. So let me check with other RCs. So the idea is how many people use MOOC resources for as a revision material. Can the RCs now check within the RC coordinator, can you check within your RC and see how many of the instructors practice this particular idea of using MOOCs for revisions? Okay, 1281, RC1281 is saying that 10% of them use it. RC1148 is saying 45% use it. 20% from RC1113, 15, 30%, 40%, 20%. Even though the numbers are small, so the person with whom I interacted in RC1026, you see that there are lot more people who share your idea, even though the numbers are small, 20 to 40%, but this idea is being used by other instructors as well. So in this particular session, what you have seen till now is three unique ways in which MOOCs could be integrated within your regular teaching learning practice, plus one small advice provided by Professor Fatak about how to give value addition to the existing resources by forming a community and creating open educational resources based on this. The first idea was use of proctored exams within your own classrooms. The second idea was integrating it as part of flipped classrooms and also considering it for some partial credit or incentivizing the MOOC participation. The third idea is using for revisions. Four ideas have been talked of till now. Let me now move on to one more center. So, people who are having an idea other than these four, please raise your hand. I will be coming to your center right now. So, let me go to Mepkoshenk College, RC1013. Yes, sir. Can you can I have a new idea?
Good morning, sir.
Yeah.
This is RC1013.
Yes.
In our college, the students can choose three online courses from their three online courses which is not present in their curriculum.
Okay.
So once they get passed in those three online courses at the end of the semester, which means eighth semester, they can withdraw one course from the regular curriculum.
Great. So RC1013, so is your college a autonomous college or is it part of regular university system?
Myself from Kalasalingam University.
So you are part of a university system?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Deemed university.
And the university provides this facility of dropping one course instead of taking a MOOC credit in its place.
Yes, sir.
So RC1013, so this is one more example where the full credit is being given for the student on taking the MOOC. So what my colleague from RC1013 is saying is that the students from their college can take three online courses, and if they get good credits, they can drop one of the electives. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, one of the electives electives can be replaced by the MOOC course. So it is good that some of the universities are accepting this. Can I ask you a quick question? How do you verify the validity of the certificate, whether the student has done that particular exam or not? Because this is a challenge.
First thing is they need to.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Through NPTEL local chapter, we do have NPTEL local chapter. So through that SPOC, they need to submit their original certificates.
Okay, so which means that they are taking an NPTEL online course, not the other MOOCs, right?
NPTEL, Coursera, SOM.
Okay.
EdX course.
Oh, so they use the other MOOCs also. So, okay, this is just for information. How does the NPTEL spoke actually ensure that the student is doing the activities without any malpractices or plagiarism? How do the spoke ensure that?
NPTEL exams are being conducted in the proctored manner.
No, but what about the Coursera? Or so you said that the NPTEL spoke looks into all these. So how does the coordinator who actually looks into these MOOC courses actually ensure that the participants are doing it genuinely?
Let me hand it over to one of my colleagues.
Yeah, sure.
Professor, we have a system like Mentor Mentee.
Okay.
Students who want to take courses in MOOC have to register with a mentor.
Okay.
For example, if I am taking ICT tools in teaching learning means, I enroll 3 to 5 students or 10 students under my mentorship. All the 11 students go for assignment. We sit together, discuss, and we solve all our assignments. Mm. We write for the examination. That's why we are ensuring there is no malpractice at all. We are under proctored way of teaching learning.
Okay. Okay, so great. So let me detail out the answer that has been provided by RC1013. So there is a arrangement like our mentor mentee. So all the participants who want to take a MOOC course, they register under a particular mentor, and together they decide on which courses to take. They look at all the practices, and it's being facilitated by the mentor within the college. And the mentor does a proctored exam through which the genuineness of the submissions are being validated, and this then gets forwarded to the university wherein the appropriate course withdrawal happens. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. So let me, so this is a very innovative practice. Let me just check with other RCs as to how many of the other RCs actually practice such a system. So let me explain. There is an equivalent of a mentor within a faculty mentor for the students. He'll be the mentor for all the students who are registering in a particular course. All the exams are being proctored by this faculty mentor, and he validates all the course exams that they do even online to ensure that there are no malpractices, and then these marks get forwarded to the university. This is something unique. I am not sure how many. So within an RC, how many of the RCs actually do this? So RC1103 NMIMS, they are saying that we do not practice, but we are going to recommend this. So RC1013, thank you for sharing this thought. At RC1313, 100%. So all faculty are doing this. So there is another RC who are doing such a practice. RC1173, so they do not have a mentor-mentee system for the students for monitoring what is being done. So this is something unique that RC1173 can also take from this RC. So RC110 for NPTEL courses, they have a mentor-mentee system. RC1316, they use NPTEL courses. So RC1113, SB Patil College, 100% people actually do this. Okay, so what people are saying is that, so RC1103, who had initially thought of recommending this, they are thinking of replacing their electives with this particular idea. RC1127 in Vishwakarma Institute, Pune is doing it. So GIT College uses spoken tutorial courses. Anna University saying that we are yet to implement for 8th sem students for elective subjects. Oh, there is RC1155, Yashwant Rao Chauhan College, who is saying that we practice it for students as well as faculty also, staff also. Great. NPTEL is used extensively by a lot of the participating institutions. So RC1281 uses these online videos in a digital library. It is archived in a digital library, and it is being every student can or is given access. RC1343, they do partial credit for NPTEL and other open tutorial courses. RC1059 is also doing lot more NPTEL courses. So what I see is that many institutions are doing some form of integration of MOOCs within their own regular teaching learning practice, and this forum has thrown open different ideas. So the ideas shared by different participants from different universities are giving others some ways or new ways of looking into integrating ICT or integrating ICT resources within their own teaching learning practices, and this specifically is the vision of the FDP. And one additional thing that we have done, that we have, is the idea of collaborative communities. So if you actually look at the current FDP itself, all the cohorts, all the mentor and mentees in cohorts is a small collaborative community in itself. Similarly, the participants in an RC is also a collaborative community in itself, and even the smallest unit, the team that is coming in for creating an OER, that is also a collaborative community. What we wish is that these collaborative communities start interacting with each other through these forums, like AVIEW interactions that were scheduled, or through multiple mechanisms. So I understand that many mentors and mentees are interacting through emails, WhatsApp, or other SMS, other mechanisms. So it's essentially they are all leveraging the features or affordances provided by various ICT resources and are trying to collaborate. And this is exactly what we would want for both effective and efficient integration of technology in your regular teaching learning practice. So in the upcoming sessions, I'll be introducing you to the idea of wiki. I'll be showing you one example wiki, and I'll be giving you a lab activity that you can do across the coming week. So there won't be any specific activity for you in the afternoon, but I'll show you one particular wiki that we had created as part of our workshops, earlier workshops, where several of the RCs, so most of the RCs who are participating in the current FDP also were part of that pedagogy workshop, and we had together created a wiki in wiki spaces, and all these resources are available in open, and it is in Creative Commons. It's free, open and online. We will do one small activity, one small explanation or demonstration of these wiki activities, and we'll be providing you with an activity that you can do across the week. It's a small activity. The details will be shared in the upcoming session, but the idea is again looking into collaboration both within your RC and across RCs, so that the best practices get shared and others can take up these kind of practices in their own teaching learning at the end of this FDP. So we'll break for lunch right now. When we come back, we'll come back at 2 o'clock. The session will be about use of wikis for collaboration. So thank you for being there in the first two sessions.